think you're, if anybody thinks this is normal, they're crazy.
Ambassador, it's so nice to have you with us. First of all, I wanted to ask, what's the situation in the United States of America? Because despite being the most powerful country and it's still the most affected country.
Well, I think the situation here is more complex probably than it needs to be. One reality, of course, is that there's tremendous diversity within the United States. And I think in some ways we're realizing that now. We're realizing the diversity, not just in terms of views, but simply geography. My wife and I have been up in our place in Maine for about the last 8 weeks. It's very rural. We have a large farm. We're in one world. If I was in Manhattan, which is actually where my younger son is, it'd be an entirely different situation. But I think there's some basics for us here. One is the need to pay attention, listen to medical professionals, scientists, experts in the field. The other is to realize this is going to take longer than we think, that we don't necessarily know what all the answers are and aren't going to for a while. It's not like a movie. It does not get resolved in 2 hours. Vaccine may be a ways off. Trying to figure out good, better ways of curing this or caring for it are still being developed. But there is an impatience on the economic front, which is understandable, but that's fallen into the political debate. What I think is important and is to for the Americans, and at all levels, all 330 plus million of us, is to realize it's part of an international problem, and that we need to engage internationally. We cannot do this simply at home inside our borders. This is not the 19th century. We have to act with other countries. We have to act with other groups in other countries to figure out ways forward and to shape the situation and not just be reactive to it. It's understandable that people are scared and so on, but that's not, that doesn't give us the right to simply try to shut ourselves off. We're part of the world. We need to react that way. We need to engage that way. And we need to be among the countries leading the way towards a solution to this problem.
But we used always to have United States of America, who was leading the Paris Climate Action Accords, and any issues like, you know, terror accident or fight against terrorism or anything, United States of America was a leading country. But today what we see, US withdrawed from Paris Accord, and the US is withdrawn from World Health Organization, because today everyone needs to support World Health Organization. Yes, definitely it needs to have an investigation or to research or so on, but not during the pandemic, which is already 3 million and or 3 million people like, you know, affected. But how we can just, because everyone's dream and everyone's expectation and look is towards US. Now today we see that the US is trying to isolate itself from everything and from everyone.
Yeah, I think there are a couple things. I think one, I would leave the Paris Accord sort of to the side. I mean, that's another set of issues, but it has, I mean, certainly there are connections there, but I think what is the deeper problem is the sense that by thinking of Americans first, that means America only. No. As I used to argue, you know, President Leif thinks of Azerbaijan first, Chancellor Merkel thinks of Germany first, President Macron thinks of France first. Of course, the leader thinks of their own country.
Recently, there was a statement from Minister of Foreign Affairs Lavrov there is an agreement that there is going to be a phase or a stage-by-stage negotiations and resolvement of the Nagorno-Karabakh conflict, but then day passed, there was another strange statement by Minister of Foreign Affairs of Armenia that it's never going to happen, they don't accept it, and so on. And how it's possible, like, you know, the Minsk group, like US and Russia and France, if they are, like, you know, the key people who are involved with the foreign policy, they are telling something and the Armenia is like saying no, and we are not going to accept it in no conditions. How it's possible, like, you know, to move on from point of zero?
Well, I think it should be, I think the point though is not necessarily zero. I don't think it's, I think there's a proposal that's been on the table, and I think that's what Foreign Minister Lavrov is referring to. It's been on the table for a while in terms of phased withdrawal, in terms of a phased approach to advancing the issue, advancing towards a resolution. There are positions that have been agreed to in terms of, you know, the three principles of the OSCE: territorial integrity, national sovereignty, no use or threats to use force. But the point, I think, here is sometimes people say things for domestic consumption, they say things for particular audiences. I don't know what the Armenian foreign minister's motivations were. But I would just say this, which is that the situation is not tenable. The situation is not in the interests of either Azerbaijan or Armenia, frankly. For Armenia, this situation is not economic isolation. When you have statements coming out from the Iranians in support, that's not necessarily the best thing you want to have. You look at the growing connections within the Caucasus between Western Europe, Eastern East Asia. Armenia can be part of that. They're not. They've self-isolated because of this. And it's in Armenia's interest, I would argue, to be finding a way forward, just as it's in Azerbaijan's interest to be trying to find ways forward. I think that may have been what, you know, some of the points that sort of came out of Moscow on that. Again, the idea of you know, much of what we're talking about with Nagorno-Karabakh has been on the table for a while. It has required the parties to begin to take steps in that direction. It's hard for the parties to take those steps because the publics are so have such strong opinions. And so there needs to be some work domestically as well by governments to find a way forward to help, you know, help governments be able to do the steps that they need to take to meet on the road to a resolution.
But there is also, like, you know, some kind of feeling this region is out of the any more interest of United States of America, because the last trip of Secretary Pompeo, which was like to the regional level, but he only traveled to the Central Asian countries, and he didn't stop over neither to Azerbaijan or to Georgia, or even to Armenia. And that's a thing that, is it a sign that this region is no more in the interest of that? And plus, taking into consideration the biggest point that Azerbaijan having a biggest border with Iran, and Iran is a major now part which is America's dispute, and how it's possible, like, you know, to have an interest here but not to be present here?
Well, I think the there's a couple things I would sort of just qualify on that. Part of this is that one thing I would note, a positive note, frankly, is one of the few areas that the U.S. this administration has talked about in terms of a special policy towards the region, Central Asia. Now, that may sound strange from an Azerbaijani point of view or Georgian point of view, but the question is, how do you get to Central Asia? You have the geography as such, because Azerbaijan being the only country that borders both Russia and Iran, Georgia, you know, having that, you know, having a border in the Black Sea. To get to Central Asia, you need to get through, you need Azerbaijan and Georgia. And one thing which we've been working on here has been talking with our administration about the need to factor Georgia, Azerbaijan, and maybe even Armenia into that equation, because it's, if you've got a sort of piece here stuck in the middle, you got to figure out how you're going to get to it. You're not going to get to it necessarily through Russia. India and Pakistan is another option. China, and the administration is very concerned about China. So Georgia, the Caucasus, Azerbaijan should be all factored into that thinking on Central Asia, which administration is putting an emphasis on. So I don't know that there's been a loss of interest on that front. I think in some ways there needs to be maybe a better articulation of interest, a clearer statement. And again, I think it is important to for the United States to be seen as being active, to be seen as being engaged. International travel right now is difficult, which is why we're talking on by Zoom rather than being able to meet in person like we would have liked. But there are ways of showing that engagement, and I think there are things, steps which the United States could be taking. Maybe not terribly dramatic steps, but steps that really could be helpful in building up, in helping the governments in Azerbaijan and Armenia bring their people along to start thinking about peace rather than just simply focusing on the status quo.
As a last point, I had, my professor was Boutros Boutros-Ghali, and and he was a Secretary General when there is four resolutions of the UN Security Council have been adopted. And when I asked him what he think about why there is, like, you know, this, the resolutions are like, you know, just in the shelves and just laying down for decades. And he said, like, you know, the Security Council doesn't, the UN doesn't have a power. And because you are always going to have someone who is going to say no. And in that case, how it's possible, like, you know, we don't have US presence and we don't have UN and no one is following up. And we had like 2017 and 2018 ceasefire being broke down and there was casualties. Who can give a guarantee, or who, because we don't have European Union being involved at all, because European Union is more focused on its internal problems and they are not focused at all, like, you know, with what's going to happen with the Caucasus. And then how we are expecting, because Azerbaijan is, and Georgia is going to be the major partner for the energy security of Europe. Today, the oil prices can be zero, but in a couple days or a couple months, it's going to be up. But where we have to look them up, and who is going to be our partners, and who is going to be our security guarantee?
I mean, none of that is easy. There's absolutely none of that is easy. But I think one of the things which is important, I think, for a country is to look around again at all possible partners. They may have partners in different ways, and that engagement can provide security and help a country provide, help a country with a security picture. I think what you're getting at is, you know, how does Azerbaijan capture U.S. attention? If we take that question, there's a couple things. And again, we're moving into an election, which is, it's important for us to get our internal house together as well. And you're talking about the EU, the U.S. also needs to do this and is in the process of doing this. I think, again, when we look at these questions, what are things which this administration are concerned about? If you look at its national security strategy, it talks about competition with Russia, competition with China, concerned about Iran, concerned about international threats, terrorism, disease actually is one of the things talked about, drug trafficking and so forth, North Korea. Four of those things are involved in this region. Four of these things, Russia, China, Iran, and transnational threats, all are factors in the Caucasus. And if the United States is going to try to deal with those problems and be effective in dealing with those problems, it needs to have friends who are on its side, who are acting in ways that will help. And so that would be the point why I would argue, it did argue, that the United States needs to be engaged in this part of the world. Now there are things, I mean, we've seen some progress, for example, in some of the military sales. I would like to see, you know, a lot of more connections on education and so forth, more business connections. These are ways to kind of show U.S. engagement. The question is, how do we sort of really get that up, going, visible, and continuing? And that's something that I think we're trying to do, you know, sort of, if we can, sort of through, you know, conversations here in Washington, here in the United States. There really is, I think, there are definite U.S. interests involved in the region. Those can be capitalized on, can be engaged, can be built on, and can, I think, help the countries in the region move forward. And I think by building on those that work, you sort of get back to this idea of an international fabric, international system, where we look at things like the OSCE, we look at the idea of the sanctity of borders, we look at the idea of self-determination, we look at the ideas of non-use of force, is in everybody's best interest. And this can help us on these moving ahead on these protracted conflicts and creating a better atmosphere, creating a more, as you said, you're going back to what you talked about with my colleague, going back to the climate where aggression is not accepted.
But like, you know, taking even with this approach, but there is one thing, like, you know, not only being from Azeri side, but there is a resolution which is for so many decades been in U.S. Congress and U.S. Senate against of Azerbaijan supporting U.S. Investments to Azerbaijan. How it's possible? Yeah. Like, you know, it's only President Bush, like, it delayed it for years, and every year it's just been delayed for another year. Why it's like, you know, is there is like, you know, double standards, or is there is like, you know, something that what's keeping up U.S. not to be really strongly present in the region?
Well, I don't know that, I mean, I know when that resolution, that the history of that resolution, that aspect of the Freedom Support Act, and it has been waived for years since President George W. Bush was in office. It was waived throughout the Obama administration, it's been waived throughout the Trump administration. The legalities in our system, sometimes the laws are there and there are workarounds, and that is in a sense what the waiver is. And if you go back to the history of this, you'll see that Strobe Talbott and others actually testified against that resolution, against that language in the resolution. But Congress passed it as it is the law. But two things. Again, the waivers have enabled us, have enabled the United States to engage with Azerbaijan, to provide assistance to Azerbaijan, USAID programs. It's engaged in, you know, military, you know, sales, helping, you know, train Azerbaijani military, working with them in terms of NATO and so forth. I don't see the United States providing, you know, we would not provide weapons to Armenia, we're not providing weapons to Azerbaijan. We know there are other countries who don't take that approach, but we, you know, that's something to think about here. I know that resolution is, you know, can make life difficult, but there are ways of working around it. And I think there are times, you know, when, I mean, I know there were times when I was ambassador that we had some difficult moments in the relationship, but frankly, that resolution was never really the factor in it. There were other things, and we were able to address those other things and work together to find ways forward. So while I'm not gonna belittle that resolution is a factor. I'm going to note that the administrations have found ways to work around it, and that certainly our embassy, and I think the Azerbaijani embassy in Washington, have been effective as well as creative in trying to move those relations ahead. Certainly, I mean, if you don't think it certainly has not affected U.S. business with Azerbaijan, wouldn't affect, you know, educational exchanges, things like that. And again, on the, you know, on where might come in with some of the military stuff, we found ways, you know, at certain times to be able to do things.
No, definitely. We've been like quite lucky to have an ambassador like you and Ambassador Morningstar to be in Azerbaijan, and who did everything, like, you know, to strengthen his relations between two countries. Thank you so much, Ambassador, for your time. And I hope, like, you know, these days are going to pass very soon, and we will be able to work again with Caspian Center and also with our institution, NGIC, in order, like, to find out the ways how we can try to present the Caucasus region to the American public.
Hopefully. Thank you very much, and we'll keep working on it over here. All the best, Yerushalayim. All the best, everyone back in Azerbaijan. Stay safe.
Thank you so much, Ambassador. You too.